Hello and welcome to the Roz Savage Project podcast. My name is Roz Savage and I am speaking today from New Haven in Connecticut.
And I am Vic Phillipson in Kristiansand, Norway.
And I just got back to New Haven last night after a quick trip back to the UK to give a lecture in Cambridge, which was about the power of accumulation of millions and billions of tiny actions and how it adds up to very significant things, be that things like the course of a lifetime or environmental damage to the earth or indeed narratives, which is kind of what we're going to be talking about today, because my class this week was about the courageous mindset. And I have a bit of a theory around this.
Good. Well, in Cambridge or at Cambridge University?
At Cambridge University, Darwin College, Cambridge, which is a postgrad college. And in fact, we were staying in the house that belonged to Charles Darwin's family.
Oh. Speaking of accumulated changes over time.
Well, exactly. Oh, nice little segue there. Very nice, Vic.
He seemed to notice that.
He did. And yeah, those are adaptations, I suppose you would call them, are sort of a recurring theme for me at the moment. And in fact, I even attempted to throw a bit of neuroscience into my lecture in a no doubt vain attempt to appear intellectual. If you are familiar with neuroplasticity,
yes.
Oh, sorry, jet lag and eloquence, obviously not compatible, that we actually rewire our brains as we think new thoughts, we form new neural connections. And the more often we think those thoughts, the stronger those connections become, almost like footpaths becoming more and more worn into our brains. And that's not always a good thing. It depends on what stories you're telling yourself about who you are and about how the world works.
Absolutely. And which path you're going down.
Yeah. And the trouble is quite a few of those paths start to get created when we're children. And we don't really have much of a filter on what people are telling us about the world. And adults do say some funny things to children. And sometimes children take them very literally. I did when I was little. Have you got any stories like that, Vic?
No, I don't. I have many of them. I'm not going to to illuminate my sordid past, though.
Or have you got any things that you say to your children?
No, but I did slap. I've only slapped Hadrian one time. It's when he shut his brother's fingers into a window.
Ouch.
And I came up behind him, and he had just slammed the door, the window down on and Titus was a little tiny kid, right? And I just went whoppo and whacked Hadrian to get him out of the way so I could get the window open, get it off of his fingers. And he has never forgotten that. So one simple action, yeah, he can tell you exactly when and where it happened. And he was
about why, hopefully.
Yeah, he was about 5 years old when that happened. Oh, it was before we left Namzo, so he would have been four. No, he was five.
Yeah.
He was five, yeah. So it made a very big impression. It's the only time I ever laid a hand on either of them. But he certainly remembers that one.
But even smaller things than that can, you know, like a little throwaway comment or say you think can land on very fertile soil when they're, to mix my metaphors, when they're little sponges at that age.
Yes, they are. Yeah. Well, tell about this week. Tell about, what is it? What kind of courage?
Yeah, courageous mindset.
Courageous mindset.
Yeah.
And that is?
Well, that's quite an interesting question, because I was really trying to find some research specifically on courage and mindset. And I won't say that I did. So I ended up defaulting to Carol Dweck, who's done so much good work on this area. She's got TED Talks. She's written a book, I think, called Mindset. And particularly, she talks about fixed mindset and growth mindset. And again, coming back to childhood, apparently, rather than telling your children that they are amazing and talented and intelligent and wonderful and beautiful, it's meant to be better for them if you praise the process of what they're doing. So superficial example is, suppose there's like a three-year-old playing with building blocks, and they're experimenting with how they're going to balance these things on top of each other. Rather than saying, oh, aren't you clever, it's meant to be better to say things like, oh, I can see how you're thinking about that, that you're putting that smaller block on top of the bigger block so it'll balance better. So to praise things like perseverance or a child's ability to get along with people, to sort of, how can I put it, sort of praise them for the process rather than the outcome.
Mm-hmm.
Or to praise them for what they are doing and thinking rather than what they're achieving. Because the danger is, if you tell them that they're talented and genius and beautiful and all of that, then when they run into somebody who's more talented or more genius or more beautiful, as many of us do when we get to university for the first term or semester, it could actually cause some visceral shock if they suddenly find that some cognitive dissonance.
Yeah, this is what I understand, but it's not fitting with what I observe.
Oh, interesting. Say more.
Well, that's cognitive dissonance. This is what I understand about the world.
Sorry, I thought you were disagreeing with me about mindset.
It's not what's happening. My goodness, what's happened to me here?
Yeah. And so there's a danger that they'll just sort of give up trying because trying is not the thing that they've been praised for. And if they're just like, huh, my parents lied to me, I'm not a genius. and what am I doing here? And now I'm surrounded by geniuses and help. It could be really quite devastating. Whereas if they've had their, I suppose you'd call it self-efficacy built up, that they've got the ability to work things through and figure things out.
Skills.
Yeah. Yes. So when I first heard, I remember when I first heard about that, probably 2 or 3 years ago now, I was like, oh, that really makes sense. I don't remember my parents particularly saying anything to me one way or the other, but I think like many people, I had a certain degree of fresher's paranoia or major imposter syndrome, big time. What am I doing here? So what I was trying to do was to take that concept, and we've already taught this semester about how you don't have to feel courageous to do something courageous. In fact, you'll probably be much more aware of your fear rather than your courage. But if you've got some tools in your mind, in your mindset, about similar situations where you were able to get through by using these skills at your disposal, then you're more likely to have that self-efficacy that I think is really a vital part of courage. Because if you don't have the confidence that you can actually do the thing, mm-hmm. then what's the point in taking the risk
mm-hmm.
if you reckon you're going to fail anyway? Is that making any sense?
Absolutely. My experience with kids and at least on stage was the people that had the most confidence and the greatest ability to take chances were those that could control themselves, and the most controlled people I knew were ballet dancers, and people that could dance ballet were invincible on stage. They may not be great actors, they may not be able to emote or convey, but they were not afraid of trying anything because they knew what they were doing. Mm-hmm.
Yet another reason to be bitter and twisted that my parents wouldn't let me do ballet lessons.
Yes, I'm sure that's the problem.
But there again, I suppose I have managed to nevertheless do some things that looked reasonably courageous.
I'm sorry, my phone is ringing.
I noticed that.
I'll have to take this out and post. Oh, how embarrassing. I had it shut up on my phone. Now, there we go. Shut it off now. I'm so sorry. I'm interrupted.
Well, Vic,
flow.
I'm not going to fire you.
There you go. It's all off now. Anyway.
Cool.
So what did you tell them about mindset and having the skills and the ability and not to be afraid and all those things? What did you tell them?
Well, I think that mindset thing really boils down to the story that you're telling yourself about who you are, which often does end up reflecting what other people have told us about who we are. But what I also said was that sometimes we only notice that we have unhelpful stories knocking around in our subconscious when we find that we've gone into a meltdown or a panic attack at a crucial moment. And it's because obviously by definition, subconscious stories or subconscious beliefs, we can't find them by looking for them because they are subconscious. But then when we do something that's completely against our own interests in whatever way, then we have the opportunity to go, huh, why did I just do that or not do that? And that gives us the chance to maybe dig around in there and see what unhelpful stories we might have and see if we can write better ones for ourselves, which I suppose feeds back into the neuroplasticity.
Yes. And so your assignment to them, or what was your, did they have to do something to say, this is my story about myself, or?
They had discussion groups where they were talking about this in relation to their own lives. So I was sort of drifting around and listening to those. But again, I don't want to share anything too personal
about my lovely students. No.
As we have a pact of trust in the room. But I'm trying to think of an example now of when I have gone, oh, huh, that story's not really working. And I suppose, in a way, I don't know if this is the best example, but the reason that I did that exercise many years ago of writing the two versions of my own obituary, the one I wanted and the one I was heading for, was because I'd spotted a story that wasn't working for me, that I'd adopted when I was about 16, and we went as a family to California and saw the amazing lifestyle there. And I was madly envious of it, coming from a very humble home in England. And so I equated money with happiness for a long time.
Oops.
Oops.
Yeah.
Yes. And the trouble is that some of these stories become so ingrained that when I got to my mid-30s or early 30s and I was really unhappy by pursuing my life as if money created happiness, it actually took me a really long time to go, oh, it's obviously not working. It's weird how some of, you know, like the story about the young goldfish swimming along and the old goldfish says to them, water's lovely today, isn't it? And the young goldfish turn to each other and go, what's water? You know, when you've got a belief like that that's so ingrained or so prevalent in the culture that you're living in, mm-hmm. as it is in California, much less so in Norway, I think, it could be very difficult to actually notice that the story is even there, less alone to notice that it might not be true.
Yeah, or that it's not working.
Yeah. Yes. Or yes. By which I mean, it's not true. It wasn't true for me in that case. Money was patently not making me happy.
Mm-hmm. You know, I always said that I spent the first 20 years of my life with cowboys and the next 20 years of my life with gay boys. So I have had...
What a life.
It was a very, you know, that my story about myself to myself through... Which was a hard story to maintain because I came from a really rough and tumble background. I mean, we were out every day riding, roping, and hooting. We really were. You know, my mother was in the rodeo, was a trick rider in the rodeo, and my dad.
Wow.
Oh, yeah. And so, I mean, we really did live the life, right? We broke horses, we rode every day, blah, blah, blah. On the other hand, I could sing Sound of Music note for note with Julie Andrews. there was a huge disconnect between what I did and who I was.
Is that true? Because just because you can straddle a very broad spectrum of worlds doesn't mean that you're disconnected in the middle.
Yeah, but I didn't. Yeah, unfortunately, I decided that who I was the cowboy. And I knew in my heart of hearts that I wasn't.
that you were Julie Andrews.
That I was really more Julie Andrews than I was Will Rogers.
I would have liked to have seen you like do the lassoing and the rodeo riding.
We did it, but it wasn't entirely self-conscious. I mean, it was a job. That's what we did. But you know, cowboys, they have a very strict code of behavior, fashion, and it's a very closed circle. If you didn't have the right boots and the right jeans and the right hat, you were a punk and roller, which was the worst epithet you could give to someone. That guy's a punk and roller. That's what you called farmers. Punk and rollers.
I wouldn't even have known what they meant by it.
Oh, those were fighting words where I came from, to call someone a punk and roller. So
can I just point something out there? Because for a lot of people, getting into an arena with an unbroken horse, or you know, to be riding a bucking bronco, would require huge amounts of courage. But it sounds like for you at that time, it would actually have taken more courage for you to say, that's not really who I am.
Well, yeah, but it kind of was. It was still a part of who I was. There was no doubt. Ooh. I mean, we just lived the life. I look at my kids and I think about the level of danger they're exposed to every day. And I've got one that's just about ready to take his driver's license test. And I'm scared to death, right? And then I realized when I was 9 years old, I started driving. When I was 12 years old, I drove tractors every day. When I was 14, I drove myself to school 20 miles back and forth and then drove everywhere because no one paid any attention to this was called a school permit. We just drove wherever we wanted. When I was 16, I was driving 40-foot trailers.
Wow.
And every day that you walked out of the house, you know, farming and ranch life is super dangerous. It used to be.
Absolutely.
There was only one other profession that was more dangerous, and that was steel worker. I don't know if that's changed now, but certainly back when we had a lot of heavy equipment that was not very safe, you know, big, huge tractors, and there were no safety belts. There were no.
I am forever scarred by reading Reader's Digest and some guy losing both his arms in a combine harvester.
Happens all the time. I was telling my kids, you know, it was not unusual to see farmers. Farmers often looked like this, right? Because they had been cleaning out their hands that looked like that, because they'd clean out the front of their corn pickers, which literally had big fingers that pulled them into a razor sharp sycamore.
For those in our lovely audience who are listening only and not watching the video, Vic was holding up his hands with various fingers bent over to make them look like they were missing. It was quite a scary sight.
So it was a super, at any time we walked out of the house, and my folks, I don't know, I think when you live with that level of danger, I mean, any time we turned around, you could get, we got bit, we got kicked, we got run over, we got mashed. From the time that I was 8 years old, I started working in the sale barn every Monday evening, and I loved it. I wanted to go do it every week, right? Working with great big animals that would just mow you down. But it was just kind of the way it was. And I think
so that was the culture that you were living in.
Oh,
so
yeah.
The story was, oh, no big deal.
No big deal. And you'd see, I mean, there were a lot of single-digit hands and missing arms and broken bones. That was just kind of the way things were. Lots of scare. If you run your hand up and down the front of my shins, it's just like a battlefield, because we got kicked so many times when I was a kid, when we were growing up. You know, you'd walk up behind those calves, and they had, you know, the little tiny feet, and they can kick really hard. And so I have bumps and bruises, scars, and all over me.
Actually, mentioning no big deal was reminding me that while I was back home, we watched one of the Alex Honnold rock climbing videos. And because he's known as Alex No Big Deal Honnold. Mm-hmm. And he is a bit unusual. Even most rock climbers think he is quite extreme, because he free solos with no ropes and no gear, no protection. Just him and a little bag of chalk, just climbing up a 2,000-foot cliff in Yosemite. But he doesn't believe that he takes risks. Like, his story to himself, because he started climbing when he was probably about the same age that you were when you started driving. Mm. He has just worked his way up through his and expanded his competency and his experience, because he just climbs all the time. On his day off, he can't think of anything better than to go climbing. I mean, it's just, it's what he does. The other week when we were talking about careers as being either a job, a career, or a calling, with a calling being the thing you can't not do, for him, climbing is absolutely the thing he can't not do. Mm-hmm. Oh, sorry, quick little side loop. This is really making me laugh that tomorrow I'm giving a careers talk at Yale. The ocean rower is giving a careers talk.
The person who threw a career away.
Yes, but I'm actually really looking forward to it, because I'm hoping that... and in fact, one of my students after the class this morning came up to me and was... she's a senior, and she was wondering about what to do next. And just hearing the questions that she's asking gave me a flying start on preparing for this presentation tomorrow. Although, having said that, you know, it's even a very different world for them now. The name of the talk is Courageous Career Building. So I suppose they're not expecting me to show up and talk about accountancy, with apologies to any accountants listening to this.
Out there. Yeah. What do they think about careers? Do you get a sense of that? My sense of kids around here is a career is about 5 years. That it's about about a 5-year commitment. And I hear this from other people, that long-term thinking is about a 5-year I'll give this a go for about 5 years and then see what happens and then do something else. So the idea that you're going to find a job and stick with it for 25 years, I don't think that exists anymore.
I don't think it does at all. And I think that does take different kinds of courage to go out into, because you're just going to have to get used to everything changing so fast. And either you're up there with the rate of change or you're falling off the pace. I was listening to a podcast earlier today and they were interviewing a woman called Liz Wiseman, who'd written a book called Rookie Smarts. And she was saying that actually knowing very little can be very useful. Because the danger, especially in careers now where everything is changing so fast, is that if you think you're the expert, you're probably out of date already.
Mm-hmm.
That's my paraphrasing. Those aren't her words. But she was saying that curiosity and enthusiasm are so important, and asking the dumb questions that only an ignoramus can spot, because the people who've been swimming in those waters for a while are too enculturated. Mm-hmm. So I think that out-of-the-box thinking is going to be one of those growth mindset kind of skills.
And neuroplasticity. I do think that's quite important. The ability to learn new skills.
Yeah.
Quickly.
Absolutely. Yeah. But I think there's still, for some, a dilemma between security, whatever that means these days, and, should we say, creativity or entrepreneurship, that a lot of them are facing what looks like a safe option and what looks like the riskier option. And the questions that I want to raise for the students tomorrow is to look at the risky option and say, what's the worst case scenario? And then, can you handle that? And what's the best case scenario? And how would that make you feel? And I think that to know that you can cope with the worst case scenario, which again, somewhat comes back to growth mindset, I think liberates you from a lot of self-limiting beliefs.
It must, though, be a scary proposition for a lot of them after be coming out of school with huge financial
I know.
Requirements.
I know.
That's got to be tough. That's got to be really tough. I mean, I came out with like $1,200 in student loans. And but it cost about $1,200 to go to school a year. You know,
yeah,
the University of Nebraska in 1974. I don't think we paid very high tuition.
I really, I was so lucky. I got a free education. I still managed to run up a pretty good sized overdraft by the time that I finished. But it was if it had included tuition fees as well,
yeah,
then I would have been in a hole. I mean, I sold out anyway. So I don't know if it would have been a different situation, but it would have been a much more stressful situation. But I really resent that and really feel for the youngsters now. And it, under Trump, it looks like it's only
going to
get worse. Sorry, trying not to get political. But
I
really
kids.
Do think that education should be free and not force kids into doing jobs that are not playing to their unique talents just out of financial fear.
And necessity.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's I think the European idea that you're able to go to school and not come out with a, and just go to school and not worry about how you're going to pay for it. I mean, no Norwegian worries about going to university.
Yeah. And it's also perpetuating the inequalities in society.
No German thinks about going to university. It doesn't cost anything. It costs student fees, and you do have to, you know, pay your rent, but you don't have to pay to go to school.
Yeah. And also then you get these students who are having to work various jobs so that they can not have too much debt by the time they finish. And you did that, didn't you?
Yeah. I don't know that that's such a problem because usually the kind of jobs that you're working, I mean, the bar business would flounder if it weren't for students.
But I look at my poor students and they seem to be so flat out busy as it is. And I shouldn't say poor because, you know, in a way they're tremendously fortunate and it's a great privilege to be here. So mm-hmm. I don't want to kind of go, oh, poor little students, because that's not really the case. But it just seems like they've got so much going on already. And I don't know. I mean, you could argue this either way, can't you? About, you know, when childhood should end and when adult responsibilities should start.
You know, that's a big trend right now, and it's a, not to be political, but it certainly is right-wing think about, do you know the term snowflake?
Yes, I about the generation heard of it for the first time last year.
Yeah, the generation of snowflakes that we've raised, that each precious snowflake now is finding out that not everyone gets an award. And how detrimental that's been to an entire generation of kids. And so I don't know when childhood ends. My God, there are more 30-year-olds living at home now in the United States than there ever have been. When does childhood end for them? It doesn't.
And that's because of the same in Britain as well, because now to buy a first home is such a massive multiple of the average salary that it's extremely difficult for young adults to put down a deposit on a home. So they end up living with the parents. And I can't imagine that anybody's happy with that scenario.
I can't either. But that does seem to prolong the adolescent period. That's not good for anyone.
I would agree with that. I think we're wandering a little off
piste
here, although it's fascinating. I would like, have I said enough about the courage mindset? I suppose just to round that out a bit more, I'd like to say something about Amy Cuddy and how it's not just about mindset, but it can also be somewhat about body set too. Dear listeners, if you haven't yet seen Amy Cuddy's TED Talk, it's really good. She has done a lot of research. She's had nearly 30 million views now. So there are obviously a lot of people out there who are interested in this topic. She did research into how your physiology feeds back into your psychology. So you can adopt what she calls power poses, such as the Wonder Woman pose, which is feet slightly apart with hands on hips, or the Superman pose, which is sort of like the hands raised aloft in triumph, mm-hmm. Or even the hands behind the head sort of lounging back in the chair, maybe with one ankle resting on the other knee kind of pose. These tend to be more typically male poses, but it has actually been shown in her research that it reduces the stress hormone cortisol and raises the testosterone in your system. And testosterone is usually correlated with boldness, shall we say, in various, sometimes for better, sometimes not so much for better. And so if you stand for a couple of minutes in one of these power poses, probably in private, you know, like in a cubicle in the washroom before, you know, if you've got a nerve-wracking meeting or a public presentation, you can actually make yourself feel more powerful and more in charge of the situation. And I do actually remember before I did my first ocean, this young woman saying to me, oh, well, if you're feeling rather down in the dumps, then take a photo of yourself. This was before selfies had been invented. But she said, take a photo of yourself because you tend to smile when you're being photographed. And just the act of smiling will make you feel more cheerful. It's not like feeling cheerful so you smile. Even if you're not feeling cheerful, force yourself to smile, because when you use those particular facial muscles, it creates a biofeedback into your hormones and your mind that will cheer you up. So I'm a real believer in that feedback loop.
Were you not smiling before the first race started?
I was smiling before it started. It was once it actually did start. There was a lot of, shall we say, not smiling going on. There was a lot of whining and whinging going on. But funnily enough, in all the photos, I'm smiling.
Yes.
So I don't know how long the effects lasted for, but they do last for a little while.
So the idea then would be for them to pump up their courage, is to find a more physical way to express it before they go do something?
It's another technique in the toolbox.
I see.
Yeah, it really is meant to help. And in fact, because our stories are so important, if you just tell yourself it's going to help, it will help.
Well, that's, isn't that a big thing in sports medicine that they do visualization? How is it visualized from the beginning to the end of the race, how it's going to play out?
Absolutely. Yeah, there's some really fascinating research on that even people visualizing themselves going to the gym will have some beneficial effects. Not as much, no, you're not completely off the hook.
I can imagine that pretty well. I can imagine myself doing a 100-kilo deadlift.
or picturing playing the piano. Even if you don't have an actual keyboard, but you can read music and you can tap your fingers on a tabletop, it does actually help to form those neural connections, even if you're not actually doing the thing that you're visualizing.
Actors always do that before they go on stage. Actors run through their lines, see the scenes, think about their blocking. They do exactly the same. So it's not so formalized, but I think they've been doing it for 1,000 years, going through.
Yeah.
Seeing.
It's a very powerful technique.
It really is. I think you kind of have to do that, or you can't just spontaneously go out there. You have to have a plan.
Tony Robbins seems to do all right without a plan, but he's not quite a normal human being. Yeah, I'm a real believer in visualization. And again, coming back to my ocean rowing experience, I know that when I had that ridiculous idea to row across oceans to raise environmental awareness, I had a very clear mental image of where that would take me in about 7 years from there. Or even doing the obituary exercise, that also was a very vivid mental image. And once you really engage with that mental image, it has a way of making itself come true, and, for better or worse.
And did it actualize? I mean, in as you remember how you thought of it, did it happen that way? Of course, did it?
Absolutely. I'm not at the obituary bit yet.
No, I know.
But I'm definitely way more on track. Well, I am on track for that. Yeah, I kind of need to upgrade my obituary now. But have you had, well, does your son do this before his big swimming races? Does he visualize?
I don't know if they formally do that. They don't talk about that much. I think swimmers, because it's such an isolated sport, they are very inward looking.
Mm.
And they know when they've, Titus just did really good. He ended up winning the 100 meter freestyle. No, 100 meter butterfly. There's a thing called Lomu. Landis Munstrings up something, where you go and you have all the people in your age group in one part of Norway all get together. And they compete against each other for a weekend, and then they pick the 24 best kids in the entire country, and then they have the year's championship after they do these re and so he won the he was third in regionals, so he gets to go. He's going to go to the national thing. So he's really proud about that. But
Fantastic.
he told me when he was swimming that butterfly that he kicked off and did the first 25 so fast. When he got to the end of the first 25, he went, "Oh no, I've done something really stupid." So I think there's a certain amount of self-monitoring that goes on, and when they get ahead of themselves, I think because it's so concentrated, they know that they've gone beyond
Shot
where
their
they should.
bolt.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know. I can remember rowing races, not the thousands of miles races, but the 2,000 meter races, where you do your starting sequence, which is something like the first 20 strokes, and just feeling the lactic acid already and just thinking,
Oh no.
uh-oh. Yes. But in your work in the theatre, have you ever seen anybody who has used this against themselves, where they were trying to visualize, but instead they were visualizing everything that they didn't want to happen, and they've almost given themselves stage fright by seeing, by creating the wrong kind of vision for themselves?
Well, I think stage fright is a form of visualization that you imagine that you're going to make the mistake. And our goal through the whole rehearsal process is to say, this is your job. You can learn this job and you can repeat this job. It may not be the same every time, but not
Mm-hmm.
every it's not every time going to be an inspired thing you're going to do, but you can do the job.
Yeah.
And that's why we rehearse and re-rehearse. And that's the old saying, practice makes permanent. So if you make a mistake in rehearsal, we stop and we fix it. And I stopped and fixed every time. Even if we were in final dress rehearsal, if there was a train wreck, I stopped. I said, "We're going to fix this now, and then it'll be over." And it usually was. I was never too. I never had total collapse on opening night, as we've all heard the stories of. I've seen mistakes and errors, but you teach people. If you make a mistake, don't play your mistakes.
Yes,
You
because
know.
you don't want to reinforce that neural connection.
Right.
You
Don't
want
play your
to
mistakes. Just
rewrite the
keep on
story.
going. If you make a mistake, just keep moving. Don't play into it. The other thing that you always tell actors is play against what the text says. It makes it more interesting. If it says you should cry, then do something else. So play against what's written. Don't play your mistakes and play against what's written, and it makes your performance more interesting.
That is, oh, we'll come back to that some other time, but I'm really fascinated by how you could apply that concept in other areas of life.
Sure, because actors are always looking for a way to play a scene. And one way to easily and quickly do that is to play against what's written. It can be a cliche. You don't want to do it all the time, but you find times and beats and moments when you can play against what you're supposed to be doing, and that brings spontaneity and interest to what you're doing, focus to what you're doing. Yeah.
That's intriguing. I'm going to mull on that
And
one.
those so the, but you teach people those basic skills in the hope, and it I mean I've had really good success with young actors who were scared to death. And if you break it down and say, these are the steps, and it starts with breathing and it ends with performance. If you can't breathe, you can't talk. If you can't talk, you can't perform.
That was some of the best speaking coaching that I ever got was breathe.
Yeah.
It's good when you need oxygen to the brain.
So you just have to, there is no, there, I was. Yeah, there is at a certain level there becomes an artistic intent in what you're doing. That is not the level of beginners. It is mechanical skills that can be learned. The artistic part of it comes later. But just as every apprentice in wood carving or in welding, you have to learn the basics. And once you know the basics, then you can improvise and play with it from there.
Stop breaking the rules.
Yeah, then it's great, but you have to know the basics, and You know, that was what I was really good at. Still am, teaching people to get up in front of people. Yeah, my kids in this, you know, in this guide course, that's the whole thing, you know. Breathe, stand correctly, tell your story. The same thing.
Good stuff.
Yeah.
Producer Vic, can we have our conspiracy theory of the week, please?
Yeah, this is more of an it is an observation. It's also a conspiracy theory about something called that I've referenced before but haven't said much about, and that's the deep state. A very favorite...
feel like we should have a roll of timpani at this point.
Yeah, it sounds like something that's... it has a great... It is a great title, The Deep State. And it is the idea... Dwight David Eisenhower said in a famous speech near the end of his presidency to beware of the industrial military congressional complex. The congressional complex, part of that gets quite frequently forgotten. The military industrial and then the congressional complex is the idea that there is a group of people who are extra national, extra governmental, who may be in the government but operate outside the governmental structures, that they, in spite of who is elected or in spite of any election, they can steer events to their own ends, whatever those may be. And that is, is there evidence of that? Yeah, there is. Post-World War II, Europe was almost exclusively controlled by Christian Democrats. If you think about that, Adenauer and who was the president of France at the same time, they were Christian Democrats. They came from the same Christian Socialist Democrats. They came from the same mindset, and they were able to, in spite of all of that had gone on before, to rebuild given those, and also true in England, those there were a lot of Christian Democrats there. They were able to extra governmentally talk to one another and rebuild trust, and it was the beginning of the European Union in the 1950s. That was all Christian Democrats. So is there a deep state? Undoubtedly. Is it a an extra governmental group that seeks to steer the world for its own nefarious means? I don't think so.
I was going to say, is this deliberate? Because the world is covered by interlocking networks of people, and by definition, some of those networks will comprise individuals who are more powerful than other networks do. So I suppose it becomes conspiracy-esque.
Because the idea is that there are top civil servants who sit at a level of administration that they are untouchable. They can't be fired. They can't be replaced. Well, they can be replaced. They can't be fired. And they build, there used to be a rule. If you were overseas for 5 years in any government situation, you could not be there for more than 5 years. It was called the 5-year rule. Mm-hmm. Routinely violated, because I had a friend that began working after he got out of the army in 1964 and never left Germany. He stayed in Germany from 64 until... Well, Jim died last year. He was, 2016?
So that's 5 decades.
That's a pretty good run.
Years.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. 10 times that. So the idea is that the government is supposed to have in place these rules that keep you from doing empire building. Mm-hmm. And there are a lot of rules against cronyism. And there's a lot of business of blind hiring, all of which are easily avoidable if you know how to work the system. So the deep state are these people in government and in the military and in the industrial side of that, that furnish them with weapons and support, that they work together to control events. Now, the nefarious part of that, there are people that say that the deep state works on 3 levels. On the lowest level, where they influence events, small events, elections, things like that. And then mid-level events where they might cause plane wrecks. They don't care if they kill a whole plane full of people as long as they get the one person on board. And then at the very highest level, this is where the conspiracy theories come from about 9/11, that was an inside job. This leads people on. So you just extrapolate from the idea of the deep state into the idea that Mossad is actually behind ISIS. So one follows logically after another. ISIS is the brainchild and the stepchild of Mossad, the Israeli.
It's quite interesting. So I'm looking at the slide that I was using this morning that I actually got it from the recent or last year's WWF and London Zoological Society report, where you've got a pyramid with events at the top and then patterns and trends below that, and then systemic structures below that, and then narratives as the foundation of the pyramid. And the point of this was that certainly when we look at societies, be they secret or otherwise, we have certain guiding narratives, certain dominant stories that tend to give rise to the systemic structures, which might be our financial structures or our democratic structure, or I should say more broadly, political structures.
Roomkeeping, housekeeping. Can I fill your mini bar?
I'm sorry. I know it's not for me because I haven't given out this number to anybody. It's probably for Frank, who lived here before me. I had Jehovah's Witnesses come around for Frank as well.
Oh, Frank must have been a popular guy.
I think he must have been. Sorry about that.
It's okay. No problem. My phone rang too. No problem. Well, let me finish just a little about the deep state and why it's a big topic right now. It's because, you know, that Michael Flynn had to quit yesterday, the national security advisor.
I was flying all day yesterday. I don't know what happened.
He was forced to resign because he apparently misled the vice president about the content of a telephone call he had had with the Russian embassy, the Russian ambassador.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the theory behind all of this is that, as I've said before, the deep state is fighting back. That Trump came in with the ideas that he's going to really shake things up and change things.
Yeah.
And I have read and heard that the leaks surrounding that administration are unbelievable. Unbelievable amounts of data rolling out of the administration, across the board, that people are willfully leaking and turning things over, and that this guy is just the first person to fall victim to that.
I mean, how are these leaks sanctioned or not?
No, apparently not.
Right.
Yeah. So this is that he may be the first example of deep state fight back.
Well, it could end up being a very small government.
Yeah, very and I also read there was a general that said, and you know, we talked about this 2 weeks ago, the conspiracy theory that there will be a coup within 60 days.
Mm-hmm.
A very high-ranking general spoke out the other day and said there is enormous confusion and chaos at the highest levels of government, sort of like, and you need to get it fixed, or we will.
Was he addressing these remarks towards a certain
elected president? No, he was just speaking out that there, it is an interesting time. It would be a tragedy for everyone if there was some sort of coup, but
that's not how the process is supposed to work.
No.
And,
but that's where
you trust,
that's why we're hearing a lot about the deep state these days. So.
Interesting. Thank you to the man with his finger on the pulse of conspiracy theories.
Not willfully. Well, yeah, I do. It's kind of like fun watching the circus, watching the lunatic fringe.
Yeah.
From a 6,000 mile.
Keep us posted.
Easy to do from a 6,000 mile remove.
That's a nice safety margin.
Isn't it just?
Yes. Well, thank you, Victor.
Thank you.
I hope that you enjoyed that, lovely listeners. We will be back next week when we are talking about courageous decision making, which is what it's all about, really.
Ah, it really
is. On one level or another, it's all about decision making.
Yeah, yeah. Are you near the midterm now? Is it getting too close to the midterm of the...
We just had week 5, and weirdly, there are 8 weeks in the first half of the semester and 5 weeks in the second half.
Yeah, because of spring break, yeah. Mm.
Yeah, so this is the marathon half. By the time we get to the end of this half, we're actually really about 2/3 of the way there.
Oh. Well, I can't wait to hear about courageous decision making. Sounds like fun.
And I can let you know how my courageous career building talk went as well. Okay. I'm looking forward to it. I'm especially interested to hear what questions I get asked.
Okay.
Yeah, it'd be a good one.
All right.
All right, Vic.
Good to see you, Roz.
Good to see you too. Have a fantastic week, everybody. Be courageous, and we'll see you next week.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye.